Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. With that in mind, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, I confess that I have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what I have done and by what I have left undone. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved my neighbors as myself. I am truly sorry, and I humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive me, that I may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and also share in his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Now please be seated as we give our attention to the reading of the Scriptures.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me, therefore I've not been disgraced. Therefore I've set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
We'll read today's psalm by whole verse. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed.
I have become a reproach to all my enemies and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot.
For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I have trusted in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God.
My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
May your face shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that is in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and he became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
With
May the Lord be on our minds, on our lips, and on our hearts as we hear his holy gospel. The holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Reading Mark's gospel this morning, chapter 11, starting at verse 1. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.' They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them that what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of heaven of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the heaven.' Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12." The gospel of the Lord.
Spirit, to give you glory and honor, do you? Lord, we thank you that you are holy forever. You are the only one who is worthy to be called holy. And we thank you for the opportunity to follow you and to obey you and to have our righteousness, which is as filthy rags, be washed white and holy through the blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to invite the children to come with prayer and a blessing. Please extend your hands. Dear Lord, thank you, as always, for these blessings that you have given to us. We ask that you would guide us as we instruct them and mentor them and steward them for you. And we ask that when they are old, their testimony would be that there's never been a day in all my life that I haven't known and loved Jesus with all my heart. And we ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Before we begin, there's a few announcements that I would like to make and have made. The first one is I'd like to let you all know that the reason why everybody feels like they're freezing to death, except me, because I'm layered up. For the first time, I actually am comfortable. The sanctuary unit and the foyer unit were set in competing modes since probably somewhere after Wednesday. So the sanctuary one froze, so it's thawing as we speak. So hopefully the body temperature will raise up. It should warm up, but that's what's going on with that. Also, I would like to remind everybody that today is Palm Sunday. Obviously, you saw the palms, but that also means that we're doing the Easter egg hunt. So immediately after the service, when the service is over, after the deacon's dismissal, please, all the adults, all the children are going to be led over to the other building where they're going to be closed in. The adults that are here that are staying for the Easter egg hunt, please stay and help us hide eggs. Don't get stuck in the door saying hi and bye. Get outside and help. We can do all that later. So that's the other thing. Also, we have got this morning a barrage of texts came in of so many people on the worship team that are ill, sick, and under the weather. And it started this week with David Jones breaking his ankle. Took a step wrong and broke his ankle. He's in the hospital now. He's been visited every single day so far, I think, and we're taking communion to him this afternoon as well. But please, please keep him in your prayers specifically, but also the worship team as well. And also I'd like to ask Andrew to come up and talk a little bit about, very briefly, what's going on with the Order of St. Joseph that we talked about a few weeks ago. Up here.
Yeah, I guess. Morning. I know I've had several people ask me kind of for updates, where we're at, and now I finally have something worthwhile to say. So we are going to do our first, I don't know, for lack of a better term, sort of lunch and learn, although it's breakfast, on April 20th over there. David Pike, who I think stepped out, so I couldn't point at him right now, is going to be doing kind of like plumbing 101, and there'll be a Q&A for those that are already passed 101. The hope is to sort of also, we're working on trying to film some of that to house it, so kind of everybody in the church will have access to that. The second thing I wanted to say is that we do have a job. For that group, we are going to do some deck work and work on some steps, so just be ready for a little communication about that to try to get a small group of people that are ready to do that. And then also, we are going to have a bucket out in the narthex for jobs y'all may need done. Nothing is too big, nothing is too small, because if it is too big, we're just going to point you in the direction of somewhere helpful that isn't us, and Small jobs will be a great opportunity for someone that knows how to do it to go out with someone that doesn't know how to do it. So I know I got up here before and talked a lot about, hey, we're going to learn in trades and stuff, but as Father Jason has talked a lot about, everything we're doing here, the heart of it is discipleship. So I'm looking forward to the men's group growing through through work. So that's all I got.
Thank you.
All right.
Anything else? Well, let us pray. Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Turn with me, please, to Mark 11. Beginning with verse 1, 11:1. Today is Palm Sunday, and that's what we're going to read about right now. As soon as I can see the words. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Now, there's a few things I would like to discuss about that. First of all, you should understand the setting that was occurring at the time when Jesus entered Jerusalem on the colt of a donkey. First of all, this was the Festival of Booths. The Festival of Booths was established several hundred years before, and it was established on the re-entry of the people of God into the Promised Land from their captivity. So the Festival of Booths was one of those things where everybody came to Jerusalem because now this is a glorious time. This is a rejoicing time. And then here we are now several hundred years later, and it's the Festival of Booths in Jerusalem. Why is this important? Well, it's important because at this particular time, Jerusalem filled up with people that it normally didn't have contained within it. So what we see in this particular time is we see Jerusalem, we see the state of Israel, the state of Israel who has been known since the beginning of time as a cantankerous and undisciplined, unable to conquer people. Remember those who wrestle against God and man, and those that were named by God. So Israel is under the thumb of Rome. And at this particular time, at the Festival of Booths, there's already folks that are locked up for being revolutionaries. Barabbas is locked up, remember. And they're going to crucify him. They already have crucifixion scheduled because the Romans have increased their guard all over the place because these unruly people are now several hundred thousand minimum strong within the city that's normally not that big. So Rome is terrified, or at least Pilate, and those in authority are terrified. Are they going to have to crack down on this unruly people? And then Herod is freaked out, constantly freaked out about this Jesus person. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious leaders are constantly now trying to figure out a way to kill him. And Jesus enters into the city on a colt in an answer to a prophecy. What is the prophecy? Well, turn to Zechariah. Chapter 9. Now, in some translations, this is called Zechariah 9 is the prophetic judgment of the nations. The nations, all the nations, okay? Chapter 9, verse 1, an oracle. The word of the Lord is against the land of Hadrach and will rest upon Damascus. For to the Lord belongs the capital of Aram, as do all the tribes of Israel. Hamath also, which borders on it, Tyre and Sidon. Though they are very wise, Tyre has built itself a rampart and heaped up silver like dust and gold like the dirt of the streets. But now the Lord will strip it of all its possessions and hurl its wealth into the sea, and it shall be devoured by fire. Ashkelon shall see it and be afraid, Gaza too, and shall writhe in anguish, Ekron also, because its hopes are withered. The king shall perish from Gaza. Ashkelon shall be uninhabited. A mongrel people shall settle in Ashdod, and I will make an end of the pride of Philistia. I will take away its blood from its mouth and its abominations from between its teeth. It too shall be a remnant for our God. It shall be like a clan in Judah, and Ekron shall be like the Jebusites. Then I will encamp at my house as a guard, so that no one shall march to and fro. No oppressor shall again overrun them. For now I have seen with my own eyes. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. For I have bent Judah as my bow. I have made Ephraim its arrow. I will arouse your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece, and wield you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them, and his arrow go forth like lightning. And the Lord God will sound the trumpet and march forth in the whirlwinds of the south. The Lord of hosts will protect them, and they shall devour and tread down the slingers. They shall drink their blood like wine and be full like a bowl, drenched like the corners of the altar. On that day, the Lord their God will save them, for they are a flock of his people. For like the jewels of a crown, they shall shine on his land. For what goodness and beauty are his? Grain shall make the young men flourish, and new wine the young women. There at the end, another interesting little picture of the Eucharist for us. This prophetic thing that happened with Jesus entering into the Jerusalem on a colt, that is something that no one did. There's all kinds of scriptures that talk, and we're going to read another one in the Philippians, which was the epistle reading today. The thing to remember about this is that the Jews that were lining the streets, there were thousands upon thousands. They laid the branches down. They laid their coats down. These things that were ushering Jesus into the city, these were thousands upon thousands of people who had seen his deeds. Many of them had probably been healed. Right before this, a blind man was healed, and it says that he got up and followed Jesus, and then right after this, Jesus enters Jerusalem. So we know that he's been healing people. He knows that people are coming to him because they are seeing him as a Messiah, and what it is they're wanting to see is him destroy the enemies. That's what they're wanting to see. They're wanting to see a Messiah, a Savior that comes and saves them from their earthly enemies. They're looking for a battle commander. They're looking for a warrior. They're looking for a king who will come and drive out the enemies. This is one of the reasons why the Philistines kept testing him about Rome. Who do we pay our taxes to? Because they were trying to get Rome angry enough at Jesus to kill him, because they sure as heck didn't believe he was the Messiah. But all of these people, thousands upon thousands of people who are looking for a military commander, and he comes in riding on a colt, which doesn't happen. Nobody comes in riding on a colt that wants to be a king. Everybody that wants to be a king comes in riding on a war horse. But we see in Zechariah that the Messiah comes in on a colt, humble, and that the war horses shall be scattered. See, the thing that we have to understand as Christians today that this is the same thing that the people of God, that were called the people of God at the time, had to understand, which is His ways are not our ways. And that the first time He comes as a servant. He comes humble. The Scripture says He emptied Himself of all of those things. I had somebody ask me a question. We were talking, some time ago now, about the relationships between men and women. And the conversation was about the difference between being submitted and not being submitted. And what you find in the Scripture is this competition of being submitted. Not a competitive competition. It's one of those things of trying to outdo each other in love competition, which everybody wins and nobody wins if you're doing it right, right? But this idea of outdoing each other in love, and the question was put to me, well, are women second? And I thought a lot about that, because I don't think that women are second. There's no male or female, Jew or Greek, right? I mean, that's the Scripture we have. But the Scripture that kept popping into my head over and over for weeks after that was Jesus second? Well, the answer to that question, it was Jesus second to the Father, was yes and no. Because Jesus emptied Himself of all things holy. Emptied Himself of, if you want to see what Jesus looks like in the Spirit, go to Revelation. It's terrifying to those that can't look upon Him, and the groom to those that can. It'll be the hope of many and the terror of many. If you want to see what Jesus looked like on earth, we have plenty of copious evidence of what Jesus looked like and acted like on earth. And that's what He calls His people to do and be. One of the problems today with the church is if the church gathers up its own arms and picks up its own swords and shields against each other. Assuming that the belief that person has is somewhat lesser than the belief that I have, which is the pride of judgment, and will bring us to our knees every single time. Because as soon as we step out in judgment over anybody else, that doesn't mean we don't judge sin as sin. That's not what I'm saying. But as soon as we step out in judgment over anybody else, then we take on something that Jesus Himself didn't take on with the woman that was brought before Him in adultery. Who's left to judge you? They're all gone, Lord. Neither do I judge you. Nay, He did say, go and sin no more. It wasn't pick up your former life and keep going. Everything's great. It was go and sin no more. Jesus talked a lot about love, but He talked 3 or 4 times more about repentance. Jesus is love. God is love. We know this. The pure love. But He didn't talk about love nearly as much as He talked about repentance and the coming kingdom. Something like 120-something times He talks about repentance, and it's like a third of that or less that He talks about love. So, if you're listening to what Jesus was focusing on, you have to read what Jesus said. And you have to watch what Jesus did. And if we as Christians believe that we are somehow riding on war horses, that is incorrect. Because in this life, we are to ride on the donkeys. In one of the great bishops, the ancient fathers, this is one of the reasons I love Peter. Because Peter says, somebody wrote somewhere and he can't remember the reference. That is 100% me. It just is. But one of the ancient church fathers was asked how he reconciled, it wasn't one of the ancient fathers, it was a bishop, anyway, how he reconciled this idea of all of the pomp and the big hats and all of the accoutrements, all of the stuff that we get, the pretty things, etc. How do you reconcile that all of this is supposed to be an image of Christ? That's all it is. It's all it is. And the man that's underneath here is dressed in full black, because that's who he is. All of this is to represent Christ. But this bishop said, how do you reconcile this? And he says, I feel like the donkey that led Christ in. He's not rejoicing in his own worth. He's just carrying Christ with him. And I think that that is an absolutely apropos example for us to follow. One of the things that you have to understand, anybody that's, the elections have happened. Up until last couple of weeks in the last House of Bishops, there was a chance that I wouldn't be a bishop in October. I was praying that God's will be done, but if I wasn't, then there was a lot of ease that went along with that. Because one of the things that I have found that is that if you are seeking God, it is not a painless process. If you are seeking to hold Him, if you are seeking to look at Him, if you are seeking His face, it is not a painless process. But the pain that you undergo is redemptive, because those things that fall off of you are the chains that cause you pain. When they fall, there is pain when they fall. But they have to fall, because God, your Father, will not let them stand. Can you imagine if your child was walking around buried in chains? What would you do? Way to go. Did that to yourself. Tough crap. No. Although that's what Christians do to each other sometimes. But no. No. He's the chain breaker. And He wants us to do the same thing for those that are in chains. And that doesn't mean that we ridicule them for the chains they're in. We see the chains, but we love the person in the chains. That is what He told us to do. Now, what does that look like with each other? Please turn to Philippians chapter 2. We're going to go before and through and a little after the epistle reading. Philippians 2, beginning with verse 1. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though He was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied Himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness and being found in human form. He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted Him and gave Him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Revelation talks about the end times, there being weeping and gnashing of teeth. We see this picture in Revelation of the final judgment. There are two things that are being talked about there. Weeping is sorrow. Gnashing of teeth is rage. The Jews at that time would use weeping, the gnashing of teeth analogy, as an image of just anger, rage, fury. It says here that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. On the earth, over the earth, and under the earth. That means male, female, demon, angel, everything is going to bow the knee when it's absolutely impossible to do anything else when Jesus comes in His glory. For some, it will be a practiced position. For some, it will be a position that they're used to. St. John was said to have had skin on his knees like that of a camel's feet because he was on his knees so much. That is the position that you and I are required to take at all times. And if you think that it is a pleasure to have all of the accoutrement and all of the stuff, as soon as it becomes a pleasure, then I'm no longer fit for the position. Because the elders in Revelation cast down their golden crowns around the throne because those crowns that were given to them by God were worthless without the Savior first. So you and I have to keep our eyes on Christ and emulate Christ to everyone else. We have to let our light shine Because if we don't, we might be one of those that are in rage or in sorrow, waiting for something that we never thought would happen to us. When Jesus talks about separating the goats and the sheep, it's one of the saddest things because there are people who said, we did mighty deeds in your name. And they did, casting out demons, etc. And he says, I'm sorry, go away, I never knew you. That's terrifying to me. And it says, the scripture says, Paul says, to walk out your faith with fear and trembling. Fear and trembling. Now, it also the scripture also says that God has not given us a spirit of fear. So these two things, when we look at fear, there are two things we have to keep in mind. Number one, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So when it comes to that, the fear of walking out your faith, the fear of doing what God wants of you, yes, walk out our faith with fear and trembling, because that is the only way that it goes. We have to say, like Jesus said, why are you listening to me? Why do you call me good? I'm nothing. No words come to me directly, but from the Father who is above. Was Jesus second? Yeah, because he put himself there. He took it on. And if that's what he did, that's what he wants us to do. As soon as I step out in judgment over anybody else, I'm taking a position higher than Christ. It's higher than Christ is where I'm trying to sit. That is the sin of Lucifer. It is so important that we respond to people in love. It is so important that we respond to people in love. But it is also important that we tell them, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And we have to be living in that place of on our knees all the time. Pray without ceasing. You cannot pray without ceasing without being convicted. It's impossible. As soon as I think that I'm walking through life and everything is wonderful and hunky-dory, take care when you stand lest you fall. That's the scripture that reminds us. Because as soon as I wear that medal that says I'm humble, they're going to take it away. Because I'm no longer humble. We do have the truth. We do have the truth, but we're not asked to beat people in the face with it all the time. We're just asked to love them, and then that truth comes out. They ask you for it. There are many, many people in my life. Oh, many. That's not really right. There are a handful of people in my life that God has brought me in, have brought into my life or brought back into my life over the course of years. And in the past 5 years, it's been a half a dozen or so probably that have come back in my life. And I knew for certain, as soon as they came back into my life, that my job, that my mission was to be a witness to them. It was just the way it is. I was supposed to be a witness. Now, that doesn't mean that I went over there every day with a Bible and started smacking them with it over and over and over. I prayed every time before I would go, before we would visit. There was a prayer, Lord, make me say only what you would have me say. Those things. And they're years in the process. Years in the process. Patience is a virtue. Patience is of the Lord. And that's something that we should be exercising, because some of them, it's years. But with one of them, it was just like the light turned on and that was it. It wasn't even work. 3 or 4 years of investing time and prayer and conversation and all, and nothing of judgment into this person. And all of a sudden one day, boop, you're right, I'm saved now. You can work on somebody else. All right, cool. God is bringing people in, and some of you already know who they are. God is bringing people into your lives right now that you know for certain that you're supposed to be shining the light into. And we pray that they will all see it and respond, but not all of them will. The message of the sower, the parable of the sower shows us that. We are required to do what we are required to do. And we can repent when we miss it, because God will bring those things around. Robert has got an amazing testimony about that that I don't want to steal from him. He will need to tell it. But God will bring those people around to you that you have failed as a Christian, especially if you ask. If there's anybody in your life, I will challenge you right now before we end. If there's anybody in your lives right now that you think, man, I really failed that person, I blew my witness, I should have been better, pray them back into your life. God, bring them around and help me not to fail this time. Pray them back into your life. There is no failure too great that he does not still love you. Even though you make your bed in hell, he's still there with you. So just by saying the wrong thing, you can repent of that and ask for that to be redeemed and bring it back. He is merciful. He loves you. He loves you. He loves us all, but he also loves the people that we hate. And if we still hate them, then that's a problem here, because he doesn't. He is in us. There are many times when I come to a conclusion, and then the last thing I ask myself before I'm like, all right, well, this is it, we're moving on, is this Jesus or is this Jason? Because if it's Jason, it's always suspect. But if it's Jesus, it isn't. Is this Jesus or is this Jason? And you have to ask yourself the same thing. Because if it's you, it's probably wrong. If it's based on your own understanding or rationale, it's probably wrong. If it makes absolutely no sense what it seems like the Lord is leading you to, it's probably God. Because it won't make any sense. But it'll be amazing because it's how faith is built. It's how faith is built. When God tells you to do something and step out and to witness and those things happen, I so badly want to tell Robert's testimony. That's how faith is built. Because it doesn't just build your faith, it builds those around you. When those things happen, no, I'm not. I feel checked about it. I'm not going to tell that. When those things happen, where the Lord leads people back into your life, and those things, those miracle moments happen that only you know about, those are the times that need to be spread to the people that hear. Those are the good news things that we need to hear about. If you want anything, any prayer answered, I'm telling you, give it to the people at the noon service on Wednesdays. I am not kidding. If you have a prayer that you want answered, send it to the folks that meet at the noon service on Wednesdays. Because we keep a list, and those prayers keep getting answered. Healings and everything. It's amazing. But unless you know, you don't know. So if you want something prayed about, and this is also a challenge to the folks that show up at the noon service, like, now you have a reputation to keep up. Yeah. It's awesome. It's awesome. We should be praying. And one last thing I will say, pray protection over each other. Pray protection over the worship team, because the worship team is under fire. Pray protection over the clergy, because the clergy is always a target. And pray protection over each other, because as we as a church step out into the battle, as we turn into the battle gets fiercer. But that's a good thing. That means that we're fighting it. If we're not getting hit by anything, if we're not hearing the sounds of the incoming, then we're just back in the back, I don't know, doing whatever, watching with binoculars. That's not where we're supposed to be. And our war horse is a colt. And our weapon of mass destruction is washing feet. The way that we fight the enemy is not the way we would think it would be, just like all those that missed it. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands that laid those things down at the feet of Jesus, at the feet of the colt. There were only 120 in the upper room. 120. But those 120 had fire on them. They're the only ones that ever had fire on them for the first time. I don't want to steal anybody else's sheep around here. I don't want to steal anybody else's sheep, but I do want to be the church where the fire lights. And if it lights here and it lights everywhere else, then hallelujah. Hosanna means, does anybody know what the word Hosanna means? It's not the same as hallelujah. Hallelujah means praise with me. Hosanna means, Hosanna is a title and it's a beg. It's a plea. It's an identification of him as a savior. And it's a plea to save us. So when you say Hosanna, when they said Hosanna, it was Savior, save us. It was an identification of who he was and an identification of where they were. So when you sing Hosanna, it's an identification of Savior, save us, because I need saving. As soon as we don't need saving, we're no longer light and we're no longer salt. And we're no longer like everybody else. Lost righteousness is as filthy rags. Soon as we lose that, that's pride. And we lose the light because we're stepping out of the humility that is Jesus. Amen? Please stand. As we lift each other in prayer today, please remember the worship team. Please specifically remember Father David and the bishop who's recovering from a lot of physical stuff. Amen. We'll start with a creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and on the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets.
And we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We pray for all the acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, the prisoners, and all who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come and share in the heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. David, Dan. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please share the peace.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us prepare our hearts as the table is prepared for us. I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Praise.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become the body of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and the work of human hands. It will become the blood of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord of all creation. Through your goodness we bring these tithes and offerings before you. They will be used in your church for the work you have set before us and the furthering of your kingdom. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you have given your children a sacred time for the renewing and purifying of their hearts, that freed from disordered affections, they may so deal with the things of this passing world as to hold rather to the things that eternally endure. And so, with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts with thanksgiving.
Just a reminder that after the service, we're not going to do the greeting stuff in the middle. That's for most of you clergy and everybody that likes people. Go outside and do it out there this time. Also, the children are going to be immediately escorted over to the other building so that we can do the eggs. So if everybody could help with all of that, the can and stay, I would appreciate that. Also, one announcement that I forgot is this is the beginning of Holy Week. So on Thursday evening at 7, we'll have Maundy Thursday services. And on Friday evening at 7, we'll do the Stations of the Cross. So Thursday and Friday, 7 p.m., 7 p.m. Now, prepare your hearts for a blessing from the Lord. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you for always. Amen.